cannot think of a more fitting song to play for the start of this show than New York State of Mind. And the reason for this show actually has been in planning now for a few weeks now. And I think all of the people that are joining me today in the studio will agree that we are honored and we are privileged to have Matilda Como with us today. And I have to tell you, Mrs. Como, that I've done a lot of interviews. I've done a lot of interviews over the past couple of years, so to speak. And I'm so honored and so privileged that you took the time not only to be interviewed and not only to come here and talk about Mentoring USA, but to come here to actually physically
thank
be
you very
here.
Much.
You're very welcome. And I have to thank, of course, the lovely lovely lady and attorney Pamela Roth sitting next to you now for being the Uber driver of the day.
Well, my pleasure, Eric.
Absolutely, Pam. You know, why don't we start by just letting, as I said, we have at the table here, we have attorney Phil Giacino, we have MJ Shea, we have Rebecca, we have Kathy Cole in the studio, we have Jimmy Jacobs in the studio, we have Paul and Annie in the studio, we have Brooke. Paulie brought Brooke with us. So there's a lot of people here in the studio that want to hear what you have to say, Mrs. Como. Mm-hmm. But let me start off by saying this. I've done my research, and I want to talk to you about Mentoring USA, but I have to say, with regards to you, And your late husband, I mean, 60 years.
Yeah.
How did you do? I mean, what is the secret to a marriage of 60?
Did you say 60 years?
Is it 60? What is it, 60 years?
I don't illegitimize some children I have.
I'm sorry. I'm looking at the am I wrong? How many years were you at Marriott?
We're married 61 years.
Okay. Oh, gotcha. Okay. And what is the secret to 61 years of happy being married?
Well, I tell you the truth. It's a wonderful venture for young women to understand. At the beginning, you know, things happen, you're young, and I was very young. I just was out of college, and I was teaching. I was a teacher, and he was already a year into law school, which was not easy for us because he was on scholarship.
Mm-hmm.
That means Mario's not going to work. He has to stay in school and get high grades.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, he'd lose the scholarship.
Right.
So I was teaching. And then I was very soon pregnant, right after the honeymoon.
Okay.
And then, you know, I had to then stay home. I lived with my mother-in-law and father-in-law, as a matter of fact, for 2 years. And then from there, you know, we got an apartment and we made a life for ourselves. But I just tell young people, it's not always so glamorous at the beginning, you know.
Yeah.
And you have to just stick with it and know that it's the right person, the right thing to do, and you just keep on going. But things, thank God for me, got not only better, but adventurous, I would say,
mm-hmm.
because I never thought he'd get into politics at all.
Absolutely. That was a question I want to ask. And what a lot of people might not know is that Mario Como actually was a minor league baseball prospect, I'm reading.
Exactly.
And he got hit in the head by
Pittsburgh
a pitch.
Pirates.
Really? And he got hit in the head. And
here's the proof of it with my engagement ring.
That it says here that she wore the husband's purchase with the money from his $2,000 signing bonus that he received as a minor league baseball prospect for the Pittsburgh Pirates. Yes, absolutely. And his career was shut court. Phil just came back from baseball in Miami. I'm sorry, let me get your mic on here, Phil. Hold on 1 second. Go ahead, Phil.
Fort Myers.
You were in Fort Myers. So Phil's big into sports and things like that as well. So I do want to get to Mentoring USA, but I want to, Pam, how are you doing?
Pam,
how is Pamela Roth? Pamela Roth.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm doing very well, thank you.
Yeah, and I mean, you have quite a legal career going on. You've had some awards that you've been given in the past couple of weeks as well, as far as...
Right. Just recently, for the fourth year in a row, I received a Super Lawyers recognition
right.
by all my peers all around New York State. So I'm going to be featured in the March 2017 Sunday New York Times pullout section,
mm-hmm.
and that's going to be for top women attorneys in the New York City metro area.
And we're honored that you're here with us today. I'm honored to call you friend as well, so thank you. Thank you for that, and thank you, like I said, for making this happen, you know, for bringing Mrs. Como to us.
Well, I got to meet Mrs. Como through another organization that I'm involved with, and that's womeninbusiness.org.
Okay.
And that's an organization that recognizes and celebrates women entrepreneurs in all different facets of business. And I've been with them now for the last 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
So I've had some sort of a leadership role in that based upon the woman director for the national organization, the national chapter. Her name is Toby Nadler.
Mm-hmm.
So Toby brought me on board 3 years ago based upon my discussion with her and the type of work that I do, and she found me to be basically a pioneer as well as an entrepreneur, and being, you know, a woman solo practitioner in handling both personal injury cases, criminal defense,
mm-hmm.
both state and federal, and all types of civil rights violations cases.
Mm-hmm.
That while, you know, running a household, having a family, being a mother to my 14-year-old son. So Toby was quite proud of my accomplishments
mm-hmm.
and being a networker. And so I was honored a couple of weeks ago when I was told that Matilda Cuomo was going to be our guest speaker at a luncheon
mm-hmm.
with womeninbusiness.org. And so I was asked to escort Mrs. Cuomo
mm-hmm.
from her home up to the luncheon where she spoke. And we basically had a great time, and we just hit it off.
You're going to Atlantic City and all that stuff now? That's great. So, Mrs. Cuomo, let's talk about the New York State Mentoring Program. Let's talk about Mentoring USA. How did this all come about?
Well, it's a story to be told, Eric. You know, in life, I guess everybody finds something they like to do, a niche, so to speak,
mm-hmm.
and they go for it. And that's good. That is very good. Sometimes it's thrust upon you, because I was already, as First Lady, when Mario became governor in 1982,
mm-hmm.
I was already into the fact that I thought kids needed to know more about nutrition and how to take care of themselves
mm-hmm.
and young girls, you know, not to get into trouble. I think nutrition is always a good basic anchor
mm-hmm.
to really know how to live your life and eat healthy and keep away from drugs and keep away from things. But when you're healthy, you don't want to hurt your health in any way.
Right.
It's a good philosophy anyway. So I started, and in fact, I was just saying to Pam in the car coming here, reminded me, I'm glad I brought it, is this book here that I started as First Lady, put into every hospital,
mm-hmm.
that is to help women who are going to become a parent, especially a mom,
mm-hmm.
Welcome to parenting, and to eat well, to know how to take care of yourself nutritionally, because you deserve to be healthy if you have the baby,
right,
and have a healthy baby, and that means everything. So the book is really well done in the sense that it's simple to understand.
Mm-hmm.
And this is free. When, as soon as they come into the hospital, they all get a book.
Absolutely.
And I think they're still doing. In fact, you inspire me. I'm going to find out if they're still doing it.
No, good. That's good. Now,
I'll check them out.
You say you started all this when you were, of course, the First Lady of New York when Governor Mario Cuomo became governor, of course. And you started this then. Now, you've been continuing this all of these years.
Well, I have, because of the circumstances. For Mario, it's 12 years.
Right.
I really didn't think he'd lose the election, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
I was shocked.
Okay.
We all were.
Right.
And the family and friends and so forth. So, and by 4% he lost.
Really?
Which is pretty bad. He mm-hmm. should have won. In any case, in 19, first of all, while he was governor,
right.
as soon as he was governor, he got a report. This is the way the whole story is going to show you why I had to do what I did. The state of police came in and gave my husband a big full report right in front of him to see that we had incarceration of young 12 to 15 year olds filling all the prisons to capacity.
Are you saying did you say 12 to 15 year olds?
Where to put them?
12 to 15. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Adolescents.
Wow.
So he was overwhelmed when he saw the report.
Right.
I don't kid about this, but he was shaving when he started to read the report. I told him, I said, Mary, finish shaving, then you read the whole report, you know, because it was a big report. And as he started to look into see the percentages and so forth, he nicked himself. He was all full of blood. I had to get tissues and try to help him. Stop the bleeding. But he got so upset emotionally.
Yeah.
He said, I don't believe this, you know, because he's now governor, and
right.
he's going to have to contend with all this.
Right.
And he said, I didn't realize this was so bad.
Right.
And the captain left, and he said to me, Matilda, listen, I know you're into nutrition and you're doing good things. He said, but you got to stop everything. We have to fix this up. Please think of something. You're a mother, a grandmother. You can do it.
Why don't you tell me how many?
All right. I said I will give it my full attention,
right,
as it should. I should, if you want me to. And I thought about it a lot. I brought some people around me who I could trust and listen to their, you know, sage advice. And we, as I told them what I thought, they all looked at me and said they could think nothing better. It was this one-to-one concept I had. Because when I was at home alone with the kids, because Mario, after law school, on a scholarship, went right up to the Court of Appeals. And, you know, so I was pretty much alone with the kids a lot.
Okay.
All week, you know.
Right.
Until he got home on a Sunday. So what I decided was, if this is going to have an impact on the child, I must have somebody they can relate to and trust and be one-to-one with this person for a whole term, mm-hmm, you know, a whole year. And then it may mean something to this kid to have that. That shows validity, that this person comes for you.
Right.
It means so much to a child who doesn't have an intact family. And if it's only the mother, or the fact that they're foster care kids too, many, many, we're really overburdened with foster care kids. So, and then to teach them the basics of, you do this, but you don't do that, you know, how you eat, everything enters into it. But who can tell them? Who's telling them, if anybody?
Mm-hmm.
So they need somebody. And it was sort of simplistic when I, you know, I gave it to the whole panel that I put together of,
okay,
these very educated, wonderful doctorate people and everything. And they liked it. They thought it was it made sense. It just made sense. And it wasn't going to be easy to find a volunteer you train to become a mentor for 1 year. But I'll tell you something. The training is spectacular. It's very easy, common sense a lot, wonderful to really make a person understand the goodness of what you will be doing for this child. And by the way, I have to say this. It's not only the mentee who gains so much, but the mentor never forgets the child.
Mm-hmm.
They have, in fact, they grow. These kids grow up. And do you know how many people meet me, even on a street in Manhattan? They'll say, oh, Mrs. Cuomo, it's you. Do you know that I'm still in touch with Virginia? And she'll say to me, oh, I don't know who Virginia is, but she's, I imagine it's her mentee. And she says to me, yes, she's married and she has kids and she's she's still teaching. And she goes into you can see the feeling that the woman has, that she did so much for this young girl,
mm-hmm,
and who now has made a great life for herself with a family. But the fact is that it does grow into sense that I have statistics in front of me that I brought because I'm a teacher always.
Okay.
I just want you to know,
okay,
that I wouldn't have anybody get involved if it didn't have good results.
Understood.
And the New York State Mentoring Program ran for the 12 years.
Okay,
it was spectacularly successful.
Okay.
We reached all of the failing schools and every place we had to go because we knew it benefited all of us, not only the kid, the child personally and the family, but every one of us. We all get become affected by it. And the statistics are fantastic. If you do mentor a child, these are valid. 59% of mentored teens get better grades, the teenagers who are mentored. And the youth who meet regularly with a mentor, 46% less likely than their peers to start using illegal drugs. Now, I don't want to get anybody upset here in Suffolk County, but you folks, you rank number one with illegal drugs for kids all over the state.
Really?
This is horrific, horrific. Where are they getting? How does it happen? This is so bad.
Mm-hmm.
And all over the state now, they got statistics themselves. And they,
right,
say it's Suffolk County. It's not only Suffolk County. It's Nassau County. It's up now in Buffalo. It's all over. I don't know how and where and this can happen, that today, in this day and age, that the kids are getting it so easily and want it.
Philly, do
and
you
wanna, need it.
Phil, do you want to respond?
Get hooked.
Do you want to respond
this
to that?
This is horrible.
Hold on. Let me get you. Hold on, Phil. Hold on. Do you want to respond?
I've talked about that often on my radio show. And it is a real big problem here. And sometimes you think it'd be the inner cities, and it's not. It's all over the place. In the presidential,
right,
campaign, New Hampshire. Who would think New Hampshire,
yeah,
is a place where they have a big drug
I
problem?
Heard that, too.
But they do. Suffolk County, there's a lot of problems, but It exists.
You can't just turn around and say it's inner city anymore. It's not
Phil, just
rampant.
Check Phil's mic.
It's everywhere now.
With neighborhoods and private schools down to public schools into, you know, poor economic areas. It's all
true.
Over.
My kids went to a very good high school, Ward Melville, Free Village. And they all of my kids knew somebody, more than one, that died of a drug overdose. That's tragic. And these are good families these kids are coming from.
And so it's the young kids, too, when you're hearing this, anywhere from ages, starting at ages 12, you know, they know drug lingo. They're coming home with the language. I'm like, that's not happening in my house, but they're hearing about it from school. Social media, it's all over.
It's not the family so much as a friend. One friend will really damage the child.
Mm-hmm.
And they take it because the friend thinks it's a good thing, and they think, like the friend, this is the friend, you know, and they listen to the friend.
It's peer pressure.
But it's awful, awful. It has to be stopped. We have to all get together on this and work at it, because we're going, it's not going to be good. The way we're going is not good. Now, just to give you a whole overview, the New York State Mentoring Program, thousands of children, we have in the chronicled, they reached almost 10,000 children that we covered from Buffalo to Long Island while my husband was governor.
Mm-hmm.
He lost the election. So I'm in an apartment now. I'm fixing it up. And I, you know, not to say I was a little sad about what happened. I couldn't believe it. And then Andrew calls me.
Mm-hmm.
He's now working for President Clinton with the HUD, Housing Urban Development Corporation,
mm-hmm.
and in Washington. And now he was boosted up because Cisneros had a little hanky-panky or whatever, and he didn't have the job anymore.
Okay.
So he got it right into the job.
All right.
And that's how it happened.
Right.
And he was really – and Bill Clinton, I have to tell you, he considers Andrew his adopted son. He loves him so much. And when they meet, it's like father and son. It's an amazing phenomenon. So he learned so much. So he's telling me, Mom – he says, do you know that program you had, the New York State Mentoring Program? He says, there is no more program. I said, don't fool around. I'm fixing the apartment. I have no time for jokes here. He said, no, I mean it. I'm very serious. He said, there is no more program. Now, Mom, I have a plan. I said, he always has a plan.
You know what?
When he was a little boy, he always had a
love
plan.
I love when we first spoke the other day, and I just got to when you said, my son, the governor. That must be so wonderful to be able to
that
say.
To
I hope I can say
like
that someday.
Diamonds I'm wearing all over me.
It's the difference of my Jewish mother saying, my son, the doctor.
There you go.
Yeah. Well,
my son, the governor. You know?
So, beautiful. Sounds nice, too.
Yes. Yeah, so, all right. So the program is the program. Who stopped it? Who stopped the program? How did it end? And you know.
Well, Governor Pataki became governor. Somebody got his ear. They didn't look into what they had already,
right.
And which this was nonpartisan, for God's sakes.
Right.
Did I ever ask a child, excuse me, are you a Democrat or a Republican?
Right.
I mean, it was so foolish. The whole thing was horrible.
Right.
In fact, that's why I was really upset with Andrew. I said, you're making this up. And he said, no. Now,
did he say, Mom, I'm at work, I can't talk right now?
Sorry. He wanted to tell me his plan.
Right,
he
okay.
had a plan.
All right.
And this is it. He said, you call it, the program is valid, and
right.
it's unique, and you can't lose it.
Right.
What you do is take the model, call it Mentoring USA, and go national and international, and Daddy can't stop you. Yeah. He said, that's right.
Yeah, so that's what you did.
I agreed with
that's what you did.
Then I said, but how? I said, how am I going to do this, Andrew? Are you a dreamer? And he said, no, I have it all planned. He said, I'll come in. When I come in, I'll tell you step by step what you're going to do.
Really? And he did.
Do you know it is today national and international? I'm in across the country and at least 14 major cities
right.
doing the program throughout, the whole team. And I started it. I ran it for quite a few years. Until this Mentoring USA was running terrifically, but now the New York State Mentoring Program is back.
Gotcha.
It's back.
I gotcha.
It's needed again.
Absolutely.
So, and that's Andrew who got me to do it again.
Great. We do have a caller.
Pardon?
We have caller. You're on the line, and you're on the air right now. So, caller, who's calling, please? Caller, hello. Caller, hello.
My name is Patrick from Yaphank.
Hello, Patrick from Yaphank. You are on the air, and Mrs. Como can hear you. So, go ahead, Patrick.
I was just wondering. I mean. How are you? How does she think the state is going right now?
How does she think the state is going right now? All right. Well, I'll ask Mrs. Coma.
I mean, her son's son's nine top age are being under.
Okay, enough of this right now. Thank you. Thank you very much, Patrick, for your call. All right, Mrs. Como, let's get back to talking about mentoring USA.
Mrs. Como was going to tell you that it's in other countries because I know she has a trip coming up to go out to another country.
Really?
Okay. It's in Andalusia, Morocco.
Right.
And Benin, Africa, on the tip of Africa. And now I've been invited to go to Holland.
Really?
By a Sylvia Simpson, who called me this about 3 months ago. And I'll go. I promise I'll go. And Greece.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So tell me about Greece. Now, there was a story about
children of children, wherever they are.
Absolutely.
When they need help, we have to help them.
There was a story.
And there are a lot of reasons why, as I started,
right.
The fact that they don't have a family life, they don't have anyone at home who really gives them time.
Absolutely.
That they need. They
there was a story about a young girl that was going back, to Puerto Rico. You were telling us there was a young girl. She was going back to Puerto Rico with this into prostitution. Am I right? Correct with that story? And you were able to help her.
Girl going back to Puerto Rico.
Oh, am I going to?
No, I said the girl that you helped with the girl.
Oh, yes. Oh, my little girl,
yes.
My mentee.
Yes.
My mentee.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Now, she was direct.
Ellie
were,
Delgado. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. She, I met her when she was 13. I figured if everybody's going to do this,
right.
You know, when I started the New York State Mentoring
Program,
the first one, I said I might as well get involved myself, as
right.
busy as I was, just to prove everybody can
do it. Absolutely.
It's 1 hour a week, and you're completely, you know, helped by the... in the classroom with the teacher. This is the way I planned it.
Okay.
The principal is the boss of a school. Don't let anybody kid you. The superintendent's wonderful. They do a lot of good work, and I know that. But the principal owns the school.
Okay.
Good or bad, they get the heat or the good accolades that it's a good school. Now, that principal is completely trained what is going to go on with this program. And that principal will choose a teacher who knows the kids who are failing, will choose the kids who are failing, and is called the site coordinator. She will sit in the classroom where the kids are going to have their session. I planned every step of the way here that there should be no fear involved for the child because the child sits there. It's their classroom they're familiar with. They're familiar with the site coordinator. They really know her. She takes attendance. So everybody, it runs so smoothly.
Mm-hmm.
It was all planned out by me because I was a teacher, and I know what goes on in the school and how the kids would feel, and I having my own children. So I wanted it all to be very smooth and easy and understandable. So the point is, from the student standpoint of the mentee, they are trained, the mentor is trained, the site coordinator has already been trained, and the principal also got a training from me when I go meet her to tell her, I thank her and tell her with all my heart that you're doing the right thing. And she thanks me more
mm-hmm.
because she wants the school to stop failing because it's not a very nice thing to do, you know, to have as on her record. But the thing is when Andrew reinstated, see in the brochure, it's all very clear. He reinstated the program, and he said it was because of this 178 failing schools we have right now
mm-hmm.
in our state. And that's appalling. That's terrible.
That was my question.
That means we're not going very far. These kids can't even finish school for our next generation. This is terrible. So the immediacy is that he said, my mother will be the chairman. And she was the founder of the original New York State Mentoring Program, so
mm-hmm.
it's in good hands,
yeah.
and it will work. And he says, pro bono. And I yelled out, I was always pro bono. Where have you been?
So that's one of my questions that I was having was, how do you find the children or the students that need to have the mentoring? And I gather it's
the
by going...
The site coordinator
okay.
with the principal together
mm-hmm.
know where the kids are in their school.
Okay.
Grade by grade. And it's I say everybody gets a training. I have to really repeat that because I don't think it would be fair not to do a good training to see what you're about. And if you don't feel good, you know, you would not want to do it. But it's very easy. Everything is very clear, made
mm-hmm.
very clear. And then what we have also is to say material that is prepared for each class of what they're going to do. And this is very easy too. Just the brochure was done as easily as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Not to think it's a very difficult thing. It's not. to volunteer? How do I become a mentor? The benefits of having a mentor for the child. Then Ellie grew up from 13 years old.
How old is she now? How old is Ellie now? How old is she now?
She is now brilliant. She is married. She has two boys.
God bless.
She's pregnant with a third, and I'm praying to God she has a girl. That's what she wants. And she now is the top billing person for all the doctors at Albany Medical Center.
Oh, God bless.
She's
that's great.
She's made a fortune. She bought a house, a beautiful house for herself, one for her mother, which her mother, she would not even talk to her at one point.
Really?
You know? I had to bridge that, too, for her, for her mother, because her mother didn't understand. I said, she doesn't like you because you didn't treat her very nice.
There
are four girls in the family.
Right.
And I had to listen to all the ramifications of why does this kid not like her mother.
Right.
And it was for good reason. First of all, she told her that her father died in Puerto Rico. Oh, no. Her grandmother, her paternal grandmother, told her he's very much alive. You want to talk to him?
Yeah, there you go.
And he was alive. And that was a lie. She shouldn't have done that. But I talked to the mother.
Right.
And I told her, you know, you're going to have a different life now with Ellie because you're going to say you're sorry to Ellie. And you're going to tell her that it was said at a time you work it out with her. But you know that you didn't do the right thing to tell her that because she loved her father very much. And now, being the fourth, this happens in a lot of families. She had to do everything. Her mother would be busy with the lot of sisters she had in the neighborhood who were there with their families, so she had a lot of, you know, time to spend with them because Ellie was very capable at cooking and doing a lot for her mother. But I told her mother, she's not your cook. She's just a little girl. She's 13.
Yep.
So she deserves a life, too. She should be out in the playground playing with the other kids, you know, and she has no friends. Well, that's because you don't let her get out. That's
you saved her life, basically. You saved Ellie's life, is what you did.
Yes,
you did. You saved. So the mentoring program, as a mentor, which you did by you stepping in here.
She tells everybody. This.
No, you did. You actually did. I know, Rebecca. You have a question.
I do. I want to say that it's kind of like universal intervention, divine intervention, that I find myself in this room right now with you, talking about this mentoring program, and I'm going to give you a different perspective. As the adult child who has survived domestic violence as a child, I was emancipated very young, I feel that you really need a lot of intervention. You really need services. Something. Growing up as a child, once it's discovered that there's an issue, wherever it comes from, and I don't think people realize, Suffolk County, we have a human trafficking court in Suffolk County. There is a problem with children in human trafficking in Suffolk County. We also have VIBES, Victims Information Bureau of Suffolk County, which is the only rape crisis center, I believe, in Suffolk County. And VIBES, I was one of their successful child advocacy cases in 1985 when I was emancipated. So it's just divine intervention to me that I find myself in a room with a person that has devoted themselves to outreach and volunteerism specifically for children who are the products of domestic violence and victims. And I can't thank you enough, but to give you a perspective as an adult child, these issues don't go away.
No.
We heal from them. We are at risk of addictive behaviors. We are at risk of PTSD, CPTSD, suicide, depression, and what we give to society is what we have learned growing up as a child. We don't trust people. We have fears. And when you are a person such as yourself and you come into the life of a child, we never forget people like you. We don't forget our counselors, our therapists, our mentorship programs in high school, any programs that we were involved with. We carry this through our adult lifetime. And I think for me, I've decided at this age, I'm 46 years old, it's about time that I go public with my story and what I've endured and how I consider myself and the people that are my support services around me consider me a success. I just don't know how to go about doing that. So my question to you would be, how does a person who's of adult age, who's ready to be a role model or reach out to children or even families of dysfunction and let them know that there is hope and encouragement, that you can recover, you can be a productive, giving, non-addicted member, successful person of society, where do we go? I am so happy to hear that this program, that your son Andrew has supported and brought this program back. But where do we go? How do we, you know, you think to yourself, if I tell my story, am I going to be judged? Am I going to be shamed? Are my coworkers going to look at me differently? Are people going to believe me? Are people going to think, did this really happen to me when I was 7 years old? I was running away. I was on the streets of New York, and the police were bringing me home because in the 70s, we didn't have intervention. We didn't listen to the child. And you, as a child, you grow up thinking, well, if these adults are really messed up. Look what they're doing, but nobody's going to listen to me. And it never leaves you. Even as an adult, you always feel that you're going to be shamed or judged. And listen, I'm ready. I'm ready to make a difference and talk about it and say to a child, I want to be like you. I aspire to be like yourself. I don't want to, I want to do it now while it's fresh on my mind where there's an outlet for it. And I'm so flattered and honored and grateful to be in this
wonderful.
Room with you right
you
now.
You are wonderful.
Thank you. Can we plug my show tonight? I have my radio shows coming on tonight, Politics of
you
Love at 9. It's a show about love, life, relationships, and how we go about our lifetime learning all of these learned behaviors as children. But thank you so much.
I'd like to give Melissa a chance.
Melissa,
if you... Go ahead. I'm sorry, Pam. Go ahead. Okay.
And not to get really personal, but something that you touched upon, because, you know, as an attorney, I deal with a lot of, you know, kids that come from broken homes. Of course, you know, no one's there in their home supporting them, so they turn to a life of crime. So not only as their attorney, I also have to sometimes step in and be a role model, be a mentor to that child, you know, or I should say young adult, so that they realize, you know, something, you know, pull yourself together. You know, you made a mistake. If we can get this wrapped up as an ACD and get it, you know, brushed under the rug and you're a youthful offender, you can go on with your life and do something and be productive. But my question to you is, as a woman to woman, with everything that you went through in your life, do you feel that it somehow has an impact on you also in your relationships with either males or females in a romantic perspective, like not trusting them, not letting them in, not wanting
Absolutely.
To let them know what happened to you.
And my show's it's re-debuting, and we've talked about these issues. Yes, absolutely, because as a woman, as a victim of domestic violence as a child, these are ingrained things that you cannot trust adults, but you can't trust men. And when your assailants have been men or adults in general, because there are women that abuse children as well, you carry these behaviors. And if you do not, I believe firmly, if you do not get intervention
Absolutely.
And services and support, you will never have a healthy balance or a healthy lifestyle. You will not look at a man again in a positive light. The American family is broken down today. We don't have two parents at home. Both of our parents are out working. If we even have parents, they're single parents all over. Yes, it does.
More so nowadays than ever.
It does. And there are very few people, I feel, that break out of that dysfunctionalism. They become healthier people. We have divorces. We bring unwanted children into this, and we put these pressures back on our children. We have to break a cycle. And they say that a person that grows up with parents of criminals goes on to repeat criminal activity. It's what they know. And a child that grows up with addictive parents, as I did, I grew up in an alcoholic household. I had drug abusing parents, that we go on to repeat those things. Every once in a while, there are a few of us that break that cycle and we become healthier, more productive products of society. But yes, it does contribute to bringing all of these things into your marriage, or if you could even trust a partner or a spouse.
You're going to be very interested in this effort that I've done. I am now with the Office of Children and Family Services that I have partnered with. Why? The New York State Mentoring Program. Because I tell you the truth, this is exactly why I did it. Because in every family, there is something going on wrong with the kid, with the parents, whatever. One parent, as you said, in many categories, all right? Just as you explained so well. This Office of Children and Family Services is in 28 counties all the way around our state. Now, they are with me because when you call that phone number on this brochure, you go straight into their office. They take the information that you give them. They carry it on to the county you belong to, and they go to the county and give them your name and so forth. So you go now, you're okay. You're in your county doing your thing with that office person, the Office of Children. Now, why do I say this? The Office of Children and Families, the programs and services are to help people like what you went through. You would not have suffered as much had you had that at your time.
And I agree.
Asset.
I agree.
access to it as an asset to help yourself.
But it is people such as yourself who are our neighbors, our bus drivers, our teachers. If they do not offer the human compassion, one-to-one, intimately, we do not trust services like this, even when we really are in need of them, because we feel
as if... No, but they would put me in charge of you.
And it's wonderful, and I think that's wonderful. And you have to
that's
talk about
it's a conduit.
The school.
They will find out how to try to remedy your parent or whoever was involved with you to go and try to remedy that, because they have all the services for a family that a lot of people don't realize. They do immense work, be it medical, social, whatever. They do so much work. They're like a hidden asset. And my husband kept them going, giving them funding, because they do a lot of the good work that nobody sees, but we need desperately for those families to keep the ones that can be salvaged to keep on going.
I just want to give you guys a heads up. The reason Paulie and Annie had to leave with Brooke, the young girl Brooke that was with them, is she's been involved in a situation with regards to abuse, and it was upsetting her. I told Paulie that they need to really find, maybe look into the mentoring program. But it's just things like situations like this that need to there are so many people that you would be walking or in the same room with that you don't
even
realize.
I'll tell you, if I did not feel at this point in my adult life that I was healed, this conversation, as we've just seen,
would be very
upsetting.
Absolutely.
It brings back flashbacks. It brings back issues of disassociation. It brings back all of these things. And this would be I find this very encouraging, but I am in a different area as what we just experienced.
Right.
Yes.
Melissa Shea, everybody.
You go through different stages of life, and yes. I think the American family, more specifically the pressures or whatever has been put on us, especially in New York, has caused the breakdown. We speak very advocately about the damage that maybe the family court system does because a child is now torn between two parents. And I think what you're offering and what you're assisting is so critical, because children do, they're unique in the sense that they cling on to any glimmer of hope and goodness. So when they have that, they recognize it from the disorientation and the dismay and the havoc that they're experiencing. So when somebody like yourself or a good mentor comes in and can relate to them. Now, do you give them training as far as how to deal with these situations? Like, if you're not familiar with domestic violence or drug abuse or something of that, can the mentor...
I could have brought the trainer with me. He is amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing. It's a gift. You know, a good trainer, it's a gift, what he has himself in his mind and in his heart. But with the training that I put together as a mother and a grandmother with a good group, it really takes in all the facets that are really impinging on the life of a child who is not going to make it. They're not going to make it. They're failing in school, and they become disruptive. They beat up their people who they didn't want to beat up, but they beat them up, and there's always excuses. But the point is they're not going anywhere. There's no way out for these kids. And that's what I say. If this doesn't happen, we're going to be in such horrible.
The whole country is going to be in
the future is not good.
I want to get Kathy. Kathy Cole, you're so involved with the education and everything like that. Let me get
saves
to just,
their life.
Let me check that mic. Yeah, she's on.
Really
go
does.
Ahead, Kathy.
Well, I just want to say that I'm so incredibly impressed, and I'm so glad that I'm here today.
Thank you.
I can see how much that your husband and you and your son care about health and safety.
Correct.
Your son, the governor. I've actually had the pleasure of corresponding with your son, and I'm a vendor for the New York State Education Department, New York City, health and safety aspect in school gymnasiums. It's kind of like a quirky business that no one thinks about unless there's an accident or an injury. Mm-hmm. Billions of dollars are spent on facilities throughout the state. Actually, your husband, ironically, signed into law in 1991. There was a girl that was crushed and killed in a school gymnasium, folding door. Her name was Deanna Moon. She was 9 years old. She was trapped in the door, and no one could retract the door. It was right after gym class, and they had to call the fire department, and the jaws of life had to come and remove her head from the... She died 9 days later from her injuries. So your husband actually acted... unfortunately, the whole bill didn't pass. It was kind of dissected so that the monetary part wasn't included, but that they were to train the staff and have signs by the key switches. That was never enforced, unfortunately, throughout the Department of Education. 10 years later, another child is found dead in a gym in Ithaca. They reintroduced the law, strengthened it, required the safety device training. They funded it, $37 million initially, and then about $3 to $5 million annually since then. There's a disconnect with the enforcement. I've reached out to your son. He was very proactive at when he was Attorney General in 2009. Mm-hmm. He got me a meeting with the Commissioner of Education and with the Assembly, educate Catherine Nolan, you know, the head of the Education Committee, and also the attorney for the New York State Commissioner of Education. Then when he was governor, I met up in his office because there was another death of a child in April of 2012 in this equipment. There was a death in Jersey, a gym teacher was killed, and only someone in my business, if this is not reported, no one knows about it. Each gym is a footprint of each other, so I became an advocate, which really annoyed and infuriated the education department. So I reached out to Governor Cuomo, and he immediately got me a meeting, and I met with Katie Campos, who was his deputy director of public education. And this isn't what this show is about, so I'm going to end right now. What I'm asking you is, I would like to let him know that whatever he's being told as far as compliance is not following through. 86% of the elementary schools in the New York City school system are non-compliant with ADA regulations. There is a huge disconnect as to who is overseeing the compliance for children with disabilities.
And that's important.
And very so important. I'm reaching out to you that possibly, if you could get me in the right direction of someone that I could speak with.
Could you notate for yourself to write down to have somebody attention to Stephanie Benton?
Stephanie Benton. Okay, I'll do that. Thank
you
very much.
You will get your answer.
I appreciate that. And I really commend you because I know that it's not the easy thing to do, and we're hitting on a lot of painful, horrific issues. And I literally was crying when you were talking. You are such a brave person.
That this affected somebody that was here in this room, because this is what happens. And this is why it is so vital to address these things in early intervention.
I appreciate you being here. I really appreciate you being here so much.
Thank you very much.
Because if I said something, it's like she's making it up, you know. But you're the real goods. You're the goods. You know, it happened to you, and you know what it means to rehab, get into life again, and everything else. You're an amazing person.
Thank you. You have to keep your mind healthy, and you may, as an adult, need to stay in services, in counseling services constantly, because every issue, everything you do, from the way you drive to the people you interact with at work to your spouse, brings up childhood memories of where you, everything in life goes back to our childhood. So if you are not constantly keeping your mind healthy and surrounding yourself with positive influences, you are at a risk, a much higher risk than yes, most of the population, yes, of falling back into these very detrimental behaviors.
You know, what sometimes people don't realize is that you could be a woman in your 30s, 40s, 50s, on older, and you could have a certain word or a certain situation come up, and it'll trigger something that happened to you from way back in your childhood. And it's something that your childhood obviously stays with you. You're going to have your great experiences, but unfortunately the painful experiences always overshadow all the good experiences, because that's what comes back that hurts you, it haunts you, and it also it's a reflection on all the decisions that you make in your future, in your relationships, and how you deal with people.
Phil, a comment, Phil?
Yes. As you know, I'm an attorney, and the bulk of my practice is divorce and family law. So I come across kids that are very vulnerable and need help. Now, as an attorney, there's only so much I can do. Like in a divorce case, I'm not allowed to even speak to the children unless you're the attorney for the child. You talk about being in schools. Have you spoken to any of the, let's say, the family courts or Supreme Courts where these children are at risk, and it could be very beneficial to have a program like this in, let's say, Suffolk County Family Court? Start there.
That would be wonderful. I know that I had the courts involved at one time in a capacity of being mentors, you know, the court, all the different people who work, like your husband.
I have to let you know,
Linda, my Mrs. Cuomo, my wife, Linda, raise your hand, Linda. This is my wife, Linda. Linda's a court officer, New York State court officer that is in the centralized courthouse almost every day.
In family court.
She's been there 50.
I'm actually security operations. I just work metal detectors now. But I used to work in family court.
So she knows, and she sees a lot of things like what Phil is describing right now as far as what's going on in the family court system here in Suffolk County. And he's right. He's absolutely right.
Yeah,
if there was some form,
but getting these people involved is crucial.
Yes,
crucial. That's what she's saying.
Well, I volunteer.
Because, well, everybody has to have a piece of the pie. In other words, so everybody has to be aware and to see what they can do and
even,
do it.
Even if you start small, even if you let's say contacted the chief judge or family court and said, "Let's have a couple of mentors out there and talk to some of these kids that are at risk, and let's see how it goes."
Well, I'm open to you to have them come my way.
I volunteer Phil to help.
No, we can connect and give me the kids so that I can put them into the program. That'd be wonderful. Otherwise, they get lost, right? Nobody cares. It's like you're saying. Nobody will care.
Even when they have an attorney, like a law guardian, we used to call them law guardians.
No.
I think they still do.
That's right.
It's limited to what they can do or what advice they can give.
Yes.
But if they have a mentor, I think they can go
personal with full attention for that child. When
like
that child knows you
like
come from me,
it
means everything in the world.
And I'd like to offer Jimmy. Are you over there?
No, I could look into it too in Brooklyn because I used to be vice president of the Brooklyn Women's Bar Association, and I'm still very close with a lot of the
Good.
Judges.
That's my home. I was born in Brooklyn, raised in Brooklyn.
Absolutely.
So
well, now, Pam, now you've been introduced to Phil Jacino. So now, now you have your contact out here in Suffolk County. So between the two of you attorneys, you know,
it's like a family.
We're all
together on this.
What are you doing on Thanksgiving?
Well, the whole thing is, how could you not?
Wait a minute.
So
am I.
You treat every child
23rd.
As though you're your own.
Me too. I'm
November
23rd.
That's my birthday. See that?
I can't
do
the same birthday.
No, you're doing the right thing.
Mrs. Como, let me ask you something. This is not making any less. I am honored to be in the same room as you. But as laymen, we're not teachers, we're not psychologists. How do we recognize the kid next door, something is not right? What do we do if we think that there's a problem? You know, way before it turns into something much worse. CPS is a big maybe. You know that. It's questionable. And that's one that most of us would hesitate to do because what if I'm wrong? How do we judge this? How do we judge a situation that we're not directly involved in, but we see a child that's acting out, or we hear the yelling, or we see a child with a black and blue, "My name is Luca." We all remember the song. What the hell do we do, and how do we know when it's the right time to do it?
I think in an easy way, if you could start talking to the parents, if you have a rapport with them. You must know them. They live near you. I mean,
I
said
the parents.
My neighbors are...
I'm saying...
Thanks, Jim.
But usually, you have to make more, give more attention so that you can filter into the mm-hmm. life of the child. And they love to talk.
Oh, I'm sure.
Boy,
yeah.
They sfogare.
Yeah.
People see, boy, you can't shut them up.
And the parents,
they're really
not
that beautiful kids. They just want to be heard.
Yes.
And a lot of people don't want to hear them. But in this case, they talk. Do you know they are taught manners that when you come to meet them, they get up and shake your hand?
Oh.
Kids that are like such ruffians. So I gotta tell you, they change like night and day. They are beautiful kids.
One of the partners
come out of this program for 1 year.
Our other partner in the studio in the station is Frank Vetro. Frank works for Hope House out here in Port Jefferson. His story is a story in itself of how he got there. But Frank will tell you that he deals with these children that have been involved in drugs and been involved in crime, and he's a teacher. All right. And he's like, and Frank's attitude toward, you know, these children now are in ties. You know, they're taught manners, they're taught, and Frank was like, you know, and people will say, well, we can't teach the child because we don't have the material that we need to be able to, this is what he said, you know, this is what he's being told. Mm-hmm. And he says, I don't care if the history book, I don't care at that point. He says, give me the classroom, give me the children, I'll teach them. And he does. And he does amazing things with these kids right out here at Hope House. And there have been instances where some of the children have run away from Hope House because, you know, they're not ready to accept, you know, they're not accepted yet. Frank will tell you that there was one story that he told, and he said how there was this one child that everybody looked at, and he was so large, he was so big, he was so gruff, he was such a hoodlum that everybody was afraid of him. And Frank wouldn't be afraid of him. And he taught this kid. It was after the fact that Frank ran into him on the street, and he was told, "Mr. Vetcher, if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be where I am right now." You know, so it's like, you know, people like Phil Jacinto and people like, you know, like you and you and you and you and all of us, you know, to take in, you know, it's like help a child, you know. I mean, if you have the time, and like you say, it's only an hour, right?
I just want to let you know that our school district in Hopog has its own mentoring program. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's part of this Mentoring USA, but two out of my four children have been part of the program. I guess they were deemed to be at risk. They were both special ed students, where the teachers were the mentors, and they would do activities once a month or every 2 weeks. You know, have little things, and it did make it all the difference with one of my children. And that was up in just the elementary school till fifth grade is what we have. So they enjoyed being part of the program. It did make a difference. It became somebody that my 13-year-old could go talk to. She worked in the office, and you know, they would. It just became, they shared notes and letters, and it was really nice to see. And I remember my older son, I didn't know much about the program when my 22-year-old was picked, like the fourth and fifth grade. So there are some school districts here on Long Island. I don't know if it's part of, I never really inquired, but it's teachers in the school that are actually take on students, and they do activities with the students, bowling, an ice cream social, a game night, a game day. And, you know, they do it till like, they do it for an hour. You know what I'm saying? And it's after school, and you, of course, you got to pick up your kids. You have to find, if you're a working parent, it makes it a little bit difficult. But
these are activities that they engage in with them.
Yep, a certain group. I would say about maybe out of the whole school, about 120 out of probably a 700-body school that they've picked out that they've deemed to be at risk for whatever reason, you know, social, you know, having trouble socially adapting to other kids and stuff like that. So it's a really great program that they're doing. But I like the idea of this mentoring where, you know, it's the first I'm hearing about it. I mean, I knew that you were coming, but, you know, to be involved and just to spend an hour to help, to make the difference. All it takes is one person to care.
Well, the mentor is thoroughly trained, I can't tell you, because there's many amplifications of helping the child. It's not just, you know, the sports and other things to find out what they really would like to get involved in, but it really gives them a sense of elan. I'm somebody important. I can become somebody really great someday, and give them a dream, something that they never thought they could do. It's like a little miracle, the way the mentor can stimulate through the training that they got. And the mentee is trained to open up. When you hear things, it's good for you to listen to other people. And you may not think well of yourself, but listen to the person. Just open your mind. See, we all have a mind. Open it up. You know, the training is fabulous because it's every segment. The mentee, the mentor, the parents get a training. Boy, do they change. And if you ever want to come and see some of the trainings,
we would love. Well, I'd like to offer this. And Phil,
Keith Howard didn't come with me, but he is busy upstate New York training. He is miraculous. I've worked it out with him with every training that I got, and he's taken over now for quite a few years, and he's amazing. I have him training now. This Brad DiPietro upstate New York, because it's a big state. And Keith can't get everywhere when I need him. So now we're going to get two more, because the training itself gets in you, you know, and it becomes part of you to train this kid. But from all the facets, what do you want to be someday? What do you like most? What is your best subject? What are you failing in? Why are you failing? And to really get to the heart and the of the matter, you know what I mean? Because a lot of them don't like to talk about
doing.
Yeah.
Direction, because
the direction.
Most children are just busy surviving.
I know.
Said to me, what do you want to be when you're
they
this age? I would have just said, happy, out of this house. I never could have focused on what I wanted for a career.
Yeah.
And it's wonderful
exactly.
to do that.
Because
and they're teaching. And
they're just
it really
busy
is
surviving.
Getting the kids to Spogatti. Get it out of your heart. Get it out of yourself. Because otherwise they get sick.
Yeah.
They get sick. And they are such so... ready to go for drugs, to get into bad things. Right. You can understand that.
Well, it goes back to what she said.
You remember the story that I told you about my client, about what happened to her during the course of my representation. You know, Eric, I never had this situation before because, you know, I've been an attorney for more than 20 years, and I was representing a young African-American woman who was pregnant with her second child from a different boyfriend.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, she had gotten into some criminal trouble, and so I was representing her. Her uncle had retained me to represent her. And so, you know, at first when I met her, I couldn't really even tell that she was a woman because she just dressed like a boy.
Right.
And she just had severe self-esteem issues. She wouldn't make eye contact. She was just a mess.
Right.
And so every time I went to court with her, and I spoke to her very nicely, and one of the things that she had told me was that nobody ever spoke to her. They only spoke at her. And she came from a family that everybody, every woman figure in her house, they were all on public assistance. None of them had ever finished high school. They all had the babies from different dads who were never around. And she, of course, was the next generation following in those footsteps. So she had asked me a number of times, she goes, how is it that you always look so nice, the way you dress, and you know, you're an attorney, and you're a wife, and you have a practice, and you take care of your child, and you always seem like you have everything going for you. You're like, do you ever get up one morning and decide you just don't want to do it? And I was like, no, there's never a time that I can just decide I got to turn it off. You know, you have a child. I was explaining to her, I brought him into this world, regardless of the fact, of course, you know, I have a husband, and Josh is lucky to have a mother and father. You don't just get up one day and just decide I want to take off a day from being a mom. You can't do that. And I was explaining to her that, you know, you brought a child into this world. You have to do whatever it takes to make sure that you're responsible for that child. And you don't rely on your boyfriend or the baby daddy or anything like that. So lo and behold, as the months progressed, as I'm taking care of her case, one day she finally comes to court dressed in a skirt and a T-shirt, and I actually walked past her in the hallway. I did not recognize her as my own client.
Right, okay.
And I was really impressed, and she told me, she said that she wanted to start being more like me because she had no role model at home.
Mm-hmm.
So over the 2 years till I finally got her case dismissed, over the two-year period, she ended up going back to school to get her GED, and she said she did it because she felt that I believed in her.
Right.
And she wanted to do it to show me that she was able to do it because nobody in her house really cared.
Right.
She then left any of the men that were in her life.
Put them behind her.
With regards to the kids and all. She then found somebody who was older, married him, has a child with the husband. And more importantly, she actually registered for school to become a home health care attendant.
Good story.
And she said all of this was because I believed in her, I listened to her, and I spoke to her, and I treated her as an equal, and not just as a case or someone who was arrested or somebody who was just part of the system.
Absolutely.
And that, I got to tell you something, I could win all the cases day and night, get all the wonderful settlements. None of that had an impact on me until this young woman came and told me what she told me.
Mm-hmm.
It was amazing.
Absolutely.
Well, you were a role model.
You're a role model.
It was a really great.
You know, Mrs. Cohen, what I'd like to offer, and I got Phil sitting here, what I'd like to offer as far as the mentoring program in New York State, we're going to put this on our radio website. All right, I'll do a couple of promos for it, and we'll promote it. We'll let people know because
we have a mental model.
Okay, good.
Mentoring program.
Absolutely. Yeah. I would like to get involved. I would like
to
get.
Want one,
yeah.
Mentor.
Absolutely.
I
have one sure. Question. Go ahead, Phil.
Where does the funding come from? Is it private?
Well, the governor, you have to talk to him.
You got his number?
Actually,
sorry.
He's not paying me. I know that.
He's not paying me.
Well, it was from the beginning, the role of with the Office of Children and Family Services is where we connected, and HESC, Higher Education Services Corporation. They won't even need that if the kids don't go to school, go to college. See what I mean? The higher education. So their budget goes for this too. So God bless the governor. He knew how to portion this from the beginning, from his father, to get the whole picture of what the child needs to really change for the better, and to have a life. Because no child is really bad. You know, it's not the child. It's the people around them. And the only thing we can do to benefit for the future of all of us, for our children and grandchildren, is to leave a better society of kids who really know that they have a place to live and that they belong.
If not, we're all in big trouble, big trouble. Because if they don't become educated, I write things out, you know, for myself, because we need to make young people develop a positive attitude, self-esteem, the practical skills needed that they master for their own lives. This can be done. It's not just words. I've seen it happen. I've seen it with just Ellie, is just one. But we have almost 10,000 kids that we covered who have done well.
Mm-hmm.
Have done well.
Absolutely.
We know that. And now it's Mentoring USA is running all over the world because everybody's it's needed everywhere. There's no stigma here. You know, whatever we're doing, it's really, it can say amplified wherever you go in any country. They have the same problems going on in one degree or another. So I'm going to Holland. I'll be going to Greece and in Italy, all throughout, all the way up from
can
Venice.
Go with you? Down.
I want to ask one. I do want to say thank you for the book. I was given a book.
Thank you so much,
Prominent
Eric.
People recall their mentors. The person who changed my life. It was edited by, of course, Mrs. Como. The foreword by Hillary Rodham Clinton. And some of the names in this book, which I'm really looking forward to, Alan Alda. I mean, Edward Asner, Alec Baldwin, William Baldwin. So many great names
all
are
famous.
All famous
people.
I wanted people to know
they're all famous.
The person
and
who
they
changed
all
my life
needed a mentor.
Absolutely. I do want to ask you one question off topic, just for 1 second, because you spent 61 years with Mario Como, and also, if Mario was here with the condition of the things that the way the world is today, what would he say? What would he say to the young people of the world today?
Today?
In today's world, with the way things are going in today's world. You know, we know there's a lot of things that are going on across the country and everything like that. I want a little advice from someone that I respect him, your husband, and I want to know, what would he say? What would he say?
I think if Mario were here, he would be thanking all of you who you took time to really come out and talk for yourselves to make it better for somebody else, which is very gracious and very, very lovely to do. And he would want it to continue. That's what Andrew knows in his heart. Mm-hmm. All my kids know that. Daddy would want this to happen, to go far ahead because it's needed so badly. And, you know, it takes a lot of... It doesn't mean, you know, spiritually what you really, what your faith is or whatever. It's all common understanding of getting a life that's good enough to live and to be happy and nurture other people around you and to feel fulfillment because you're put here on this earth to do some good things if you can. And why not? Try it. It's better than not doing something good for someone else.
One of the things that I remember, and that's a story that Phil had told, and he talks to his children, and you told me this, Phil, that you told your kids this. He was stopped. Tell the story of you were stopped by a police officer and you didn't have your wallet out of respect. What happened? Go ahead. If you would share that story a little bit. Just share this story, Phil. God, you were on your phone.
I was in a light. But the officer thought that I had been on my phone when I was driving. So I'm in a suit in my car. He pulls me over. And I didn't have my wallet. And he comes up and he says, sir, you are on your phone. And instead of arguing with the man, I said to him, officer, I'm very sorry. He said, license and registration. I said, you know what? I don't have it on me. I said, I can show you my business card. And he liked the fact that I didn't argue with him. He went back into his patrol car. 5 minutes later, he came back. He said, we're on the same team. Now, I still don't know what he meant. I'm a former prosecutor, but I don't know if he meant that. And he said, I'm not going to give you a ticket. Have a nice day. Stay off your phone. But the point he made is, instead of arguing, he's an authority figure. It doesn't matter that I'm an attorney. He has authority over me when he pulled me over. I could have been a jerk and argued with the man, or I could have been respectful like I was. And I still thought I was going to get the ticket anyway. But he didn't give me the ticket. And every time in my life that I'd been stopped, if you act respectful, they're not going to hit you hard. If you act foolish, they're going to take their ticket book out and walk around your car and probably find a number of reasons to ticket you. But the bottom line is be respectful to authority figures, and you'll be a lot better off than if you don't.
And he told me, he said when that happened, he said that's what he told his kids. Phil has children, you know, his children, older children too.
Wonderful story.
I have 9 children, by the way, and Melissa here has 8. She has 8 children. So we're proud to be able to say that we're populating your mentor program.
Wonderful.
And I tell you, anybody that would have you...
And the children are in good hands, I can see that.
Thank you very much.
Can I just ask one quick question?
Sure, please, Kat.
New York City system.
Do you have a mentor specifically for the New York City school system, or can any of the principals reach out? Because I have invited a friend.
All the principals. We're meeting all the principals.
All the principals.
Oh, they're all on board. I had 65 at the Executive Mansion about a month ago now when I first started.
Right.
And the superintendents. They packed the mansion. They came in and it was all packed with them. And they all want it. It wasn't like that when I started, by the way.
That's wonderful.
But now they realize the need is great. And Absolutely. They're so happy it's been reinstated.
Absolutely. So are we. So, we're very happy, too.
Right,
so
yeah. Well, so if somebody wants to participate, what would be the steps?
You have the brochure. Okay. Please pass that number around. I didn't bring more brochures.
So you would call that 1-844?
Mention the number. That's the Office of Children and Family Services
884,
number.
Yes. It's 1-844-337-6304. That's 1-844-337-6304. The website is www.ny.gov/mentoring. And like I said, we'll put it up on the website. We'll have a link to it, and we'll talk about it. And you guys,
the website,
it's all here.
Everything.
This is, you know, when you leave here today, guys, you know this program exists. And let people know. Let's let people know. Talk about it on your shows. Mention it on your Facebook pages, whatever. Whatever it takes, let's let people know that the program exists, because there's a child out there that's waiting to be for somebody to care about them. You know, that's the whole
Eric,
thing.
Eric, you're an angel.
Thank you. I am. I truly am. I think.
And humble.
I just said that to the governor's mother. I can't believe it. I didn't mean it, Andrew. I was only kidding. She never listened.
Mrs. Cuomo, my wife has suggested that I need a mentor, that I am ill-behaved and ill-mannered.
If she suggested you needed
it. I probably do.
There you go. All right, everybody. I'm going to give you. I want to give you a round of applause. And I want to thank all of you for listening today. I want to thank my wife, Linda, for bringing donuts and coffee. I want to thank Kathy. I want to thank Rebecca, Melissa, Phil, Jimmy. Where's Jolene? Where is Jolene?
Jolene's right here.
Jolene. Where's Jolene? I'm going to get to you in a second. Pamela Roth, I didn't forget you. I was going to talk to you about you in a second. You know what? It's funny, because I said to Pam yesterday, I said, number one attorney in the state. She says, don't stop. Jolene, where's Jolene? Open the door. Let me see.
Jolene's hiding in the corner over here.
There she is, Jolene, of course. And of course, Pam, I got to say, I was going to save you for last, because thank you. Thank you. I mean, what you did, you got to understand, guys, what she did. She actually went into the city, all right, drove into the city, picked up Mrs. Cuomo, and brought her to Long Island so that we could talk to her today. So, Pamela Roth, you know, and I want you and Phil to get together, because you're both amazing attorneys.
Thank you.
You know what I'm saying? I think at the alliance here, if you want to call it that, Phil. You know, now you met Pam, Phil, you know, guys. God bless you all, okay?
Eric, you know what I do want to share with you?
Sure.
The fact that I am going to be a mentor in Mrs. Cuomo's mentoring program.
Very good. There you go.
I received all the information the other day, the packet, and I'm in the process of filling it out. So I'm going to be one of the mentors in her program.
Very good. Everybody out there, if you have the time and the desire, please do it. All right. I want to thank everybody once again. Thank all my listeners for listening today. And again, Mrs. Cuomo, thank you so much. Thank
pleasure.
You.
Thank
people
you.
Want to
thank
take.
You,
they
want,
you guys want to take pictures, so I'm going to let you get.
Yes,
so
yeah.
Hang around, have a donut. All right. For WLINY.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Have a great day.